Folks, we're going to be having a look. I've entitled the series that we're going to look at Advancing Through Ephesians. And the reason why I've done that is the book of Ephesians is a book of what we would call advanced doctrine. If you read the book of Romans and you then read the book of Ephesians, and you take Romans and you read it, and then you go straight into Ephesians, you will see that much of what is taught in the book of Romans is expounded on in Ephesians. And Paul the Apostle writes to the church at Ephesus, and he gives them additional teaching. So that's why I've entitled this series, Advancing Through Ephesians. We're going to look at four Sundays of doing Ephesians, and then we're going to break for two as we consider Palm Sunday, and then Good Friday, and then obviously the Resurrection Sunday, and then we will pick up on Ephesians again. So our series is going to be a series. It's not a mini-series. It's going to be a number of weeks. I'm looking at possibly about 8 or 10 weeks, depending on how we go. And however, we will have a look at the break in between as we consider that. So if you're planning or you're wanting to get this, please know that that's how we're going to be doing it. It will be put on Facebook with a link to YouTube. I never watch those things because I don't like looking at myself. It's just one of those things. I don't know about you, but I just don't like my own voice, and I don't like seeing myself on television. So anyway, we're going to have a look at a number of things this morning. Advancing through Ephesians part 1. And naturally, we're going to look at Ephesians chapter 1, and we start in verse 1, where we look at a new man in Christ. Paul the Apostle writes to the church in Ephesus, and he, you know what I find so fascinating with the scriptures is we would write and we would give a whole long expose, and then we sign it at the end. 18 or whatever the case may be. And Paul, in those days, they would write and they would say, who's writing? Now, why do you think that was so? Well, because they had scrolls. And can you imagine them scrolling the whole thing out to say, actually, who's written it? So it starts by saying, who's writing the letter? And then sometimes halfway between or a quarter way between, there will be a brief blessing where it will be stopped for a moment and then carried on because there was no divisions in those days. So Paul starts off and he says who he is. He introduces himself. Paul. He's now no longer known as Saul. His Hebrew name Saul. He's Paul. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. He says, I'm Paul. I'm the ordained man of God who is writing this to you. And he doesn't say it because he wants to make glory himself. He brings the importance of the message of what he's about to bring. He says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus, grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, a couple of things interest me here. The first thing is he says, and to the saints. Who were the saints? The believers. Right? So he says, I write to you, I greet you. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, this is your apostle, this is God's word, to the saints, that's the believers, which are in Ephesus, and to the faithful. Now, why does he write this? In Romans, he doesn't say that. He doesn't speak about the faithful. In writing to the Ephesians, though, he says, and to the faithful. Well, were not all the saints faithful? I mean, what is he trying to get at here? The saints and the faithful. He doesn't say to the saints who are the faithful. He says to the saints and to the faithful. Interesting. What is that? Simple. The faithful were the ones who were faithful in reading and establishing themselves in the Word. In other words, you've got the saints who believed, and yes, we believe, and thank you, we believe, and I'm going to trust, and that's it. But then you had the faithful, the ones who would go and study the Scriptures, read, and he says, to the saints and to the faithful. Why? He's writing advanced doctrine. He's writing to them and he's saying, grace to you and peace from God our Father. Why does he say peace? Well, in Romans chapter 5, verse 1, who he knows the Ephesians would have read, he says in Romans 5, 1, that you can have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. So now he's saying, grace to you and peace. Why is he saying that? Well, he knows if they've read, if they're saints and if they're faithful, they would have read, they would have studied, they would have read his letters, they would know what he's writing about, and he's saying, grace and peace to you. He can give them peace now because they would understand what peace is. I mean, you know, it's not like, you want a piece of me? It's peace, absolute of total peace. And where does the peace come from? From God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. This passage is a fantastic passage to prove the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. That when people say, oh no, well, you know, I believe in God the Father, but Jesus, well, he wasn't God. Well, hold on a minute. If he says in Romans chapter 5 verse 1 that you can have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, and then he says, I greet you and I give you grace and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. He's equating the two as equal. Just to show you there, in Acts 13:9, when Paul was being converted from being a Hebrew who was persecuting the believers, Luke writes and he says, then Saul, in brackets, who is also called Paul. Notice that Paul was always known as Paul to the Greeks, to the Gentiles. If you walked in and they would introduce you, they would say, this is Paul. But if it was with Hebrews, they'd say, this is Saul. However, once he gets converted, he completely and totally changes and refers to himself as Paul, even to the Jews. Why? To indicate the change that has been brought. That's just something I put in there for you. Philippians chapter 3, verse 4 and 5 says this, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, Paul writing to the Philippians and say, though I might, notice he doesn't say, though I do have. He says, though I might, in other words saying, I could have confidence in the flesh. If any other man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I will. So Paul's saying, look, if there's any of you who think you can have confidence in your own abilities, if you think that, I could actually think that. And I have a greater ability to think that. Why? Because I was circumcised on the eighth day. I was the stock of Israel. I was of the tribe of Benjamin. Benjamin seen as the main tribe in Israel. And a Hebrew of Hebrews. And that's like, I sat across the way from our school ducks last night. So he wasn't just head boy. He was ducks, right? Then he told me what he believed. Amazing when you come with the word of God, the wisdom that comes from God's word, you can teach people that the world says are brilliant men. And you teach them such simple truths of the word. And he left me, he said, when you in Joburg, you're coming to visit me. Anyway, well, I don't know. I think I'll just make sure that I do book somewhere else to stay just in case once I get talking. If any man thinketh where he might trust in the flesh, I more. I more. Paul's saying, listen, if anybody here thinks that you can claim ability in the flesh, I more. Why? Because I knew the law. I was a Pharisee. Concerning zeal, that word zeal, to be zealous, to be fervent, to be absolute, to be resolute. Concerning zeal, to be resolute, I was persecuting the church. Man, I so believe in the fact that my right, because I was circumcised on the eighth day, I so believed in the fact that I was of the stock of Israel, I so believed that I was of the tribe of Benjamin, and I so believed that I was a Hebrew of Hebrews. I so believed that, and I so believed and knew the law beyond anything, better than anybody. I was a Pharisee. I so believed that I had a zeal, I had a desire, I had a fervent way going and persecuting the church, touching righteousness, which is of the law. In other words, he says, in terms of the law, man, I was a righteous man. Blameless in terms of the law. But, what things were gain to me. Why? Gain in terms of the law and what the Jews believed. Those I counted loss for Christ. In other words, if you think that your abilities are great, whatever you think, I tell you, I can claim greater than that. I can claim all of that, but all of that I can claim, you know what? It's absolute loss for me. I know what, if I was to come and claim and say, I'm better than all of you, I'm actually saying, I'm at more of a loss than you are. That's what Paul's saying here. Religion, folks, religion is a hindrance. Hear me on this. Religion is a hindrance to your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, I said last night to the chaps as we were speaking, I said, guys, I want to let you know that I am not a religious man. Well, I'll tell you the archbishop. How can you say you're not religious? You're a pastor. How can you say you're not religious? I said, exactly. Because I'm not a religious man. I'm a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ and the finished work of what he did on the cross of Calvary. I follow the Lord Jesus Christ. I do not follow religion. I follow what God's word tells me. And if I follow what God's word tells me, God's word says to me, my abilities are useless. Useless when I come to the Lord. So then if I walk into any organization and there's any religious act, you know what I'm doing? I'm actually walking further away from the Lord. That's why the scriptures say, in your weakness, when you are down and out, when you are on your knees and you say, Lord, I just cannot do this anymore without you. When the world looks at you and sees you on your knees and says, man, you're weak. God says, my friend, you're strong because you're trusting in what I can do. And that's the important thing. And Paul recognized that and realized that. And he got to a point that not only was he a new man, he recognized his position in grace. Ephesians 1, 3 and 4. He writes, he said, blessed be God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, in Christ, according as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Notice, blessed be God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. That word blessed there is a verb. It's conferring. Paul's conferring and saying, Lord, you are a blessing to me. You are a real blessing. Somebody comes and gives you a gift and you say, oh, you're such a honey. You're such a blessing to me. You must have done the dishes to be a blessing or something. You haven't? Okay, all right. You do the dishes, gentlemen, and your wife walks into the kitchen. Jimmy's slaving away and she's been cooking and she has to go and do something else and take care of something else. She comes back. The dishes are packed in the dishwasher. And she says, my darling, you are a blessing to me. And you say, the one for me, I just told my daughter to pack the dishwasher. But anyway, we'll take the credit. You are a blessing. Paul says, God, you are a blessing to me. Why are you a blessing to me? Who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ? Lord, you're a blessing to me because you know what? I recognize you've blessed me. You've given me everything that I could ever wish for. All spiritual blessings, not some. All spiritual blessings. But where are these spiritual blessings? In heavenly places, in Christ. According as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. Notice the in him. Many people come and they take it and say, you see, what happens is, before you inform God chooses you, he decides whether you're going to go to heaven or not. No. Read the verse. Read the sentence. It says, you are chosen in him. That means, if I want to become part of the chosen, what do I have to do? I've got to be in Christ. And how am I going to get in Christ? The word of God tells me, my faith in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ puts me in Christ. The Holy Spirit, the moment I confess and acknowledge that, seals me, and I am now in Christ. And because I'm in Christ, now I get the blessing, which has been there for me since the foundation of the world. Why? Because God has ordained it to be in Christ. That's why Paul's saying, Lord, you're such a blessing to me. You know what? Because I see that even though I was going, he was going around persecuting believers. He was doing things which were diabolical. And then he says, but Lord, you blessed me. Why? Because that blessing was waiting. Now, at Bible study on Wednesday, I said to the ladies, I'm going to use this example. One of the ladies had a gift given to her. And I get nervous when people give people gifts because I think, and then there's people. I'm looking, and I'm saying, but this thing is wrapped in Christmas paper. I looked at the gift. I missed something here. But it was in the suitcase. It wasn't unpacked. And it was given on Wednesday. And we all sat there, open it, open it! And out came the New Zealand thingamajoggy and whatever, New Zealand, New Zealand. And I said, ladies, with your permission, I'm going to use this. Because you know what? That speaks to me about this verse. Let me ask you, when was that gift? When was it? The receiver's gift. When was it? The moment it was bought and paid for. Not so. But when did she enjoy the blessing of that gift? Only when she knew about it and opened it. Not so. Blessed be God and the Father who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings. Folks, we have the same spiritual blessings. But you know what the sad thing about it is? Well, let me take a step back. The good thing is that you know about it. You know about this gift. But the sad thing is the people that should be sitting in these chairs that are empty and don't know about it. But the good thing is you can go and tell them that there is an unopened gift that they need to be blessed with. Why? Because it's everything we need. What amazing gift was given and said when Paul the Apostle says, that we, what is this that chosen in the foundation of the world? Why did God choose us? That we should be holy, yes, and without blame, yes, before Him. Amen. But how? Okay? So Lord, you've chosen me, because if I choose the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm chosen in Christ, and I then come before you, and I am holy, I am blameless as I come before you. How did you give that to me? That beautiful word, in love. I'm going to play in love. And what is that? Romans 8, 32. That He, that's God the Father, spared not His own Son, but delivered Him up for us. Or, notice, God spared not His own Son and delivered Him up for us. Or, not Son, or every single soul. God has delivered the Lord Jesus Christ up for every soul. He spared not His own Son, delivered up for us all. How shall He not with Him also freely give us all things? Colossians 2:10. And ye, that word the ye I've said before, it's plural. Ye, all of you, are complete in Him. So all that believe are complete in Him, which is the head of all principality and power. Folks, you're complete in the Lord Jesus Christ. You have everything that you need. Why? Because you have all spiritual blessings. I sat with a guy last night who's been a pretty successful businessman, and he said, you know what, I'm just so tired of chasing money. I said, put, I've got no problem with it. Send some of it our way. I'll give you the church bank account. And you don't have to chase it anymore. I'll tell you where it is. I'll show you what to do with it. And he says, oh, I'll have to have coffee with you. Now, I don't know what that means. Okay. I don't think he's going to give me an excuse why he can't give it. But anyway, nonetheless, I'll present to him the loan repayments that we have for the land and whatever. So there was a reason why I had to be there. I mean, after 35 years, the guys have had a lot of time to build up some reserves. We'll speak to them. None of us. And, you know, the scriptures don't lie. We can take them personally. You know, we can convince ourselves for a while. But man, God's word is like a mirror. You know, eventually, after the third day of staring in the mirror, that pimple's going to let you know it's still there. No matter how you try and deny it, God's word is going to judge us in the sense of not condemnation, but, folks, to filter us, to filter our minds, to filter us to a point where Paul writes to Timothy and he says that if we study God's word, 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show yourself approved unto God. How do we become approved unto God? It's God's word that filters our minds and makes us equipped to be able to share what God wants us to share. That's how we become approved. How do I know that? Because God's word tells me that beyond all measure. John 17:24, Jesus says, Father, I will that also, I beg your pardon, Father, I will that also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me. For thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. Jesus is saying, how? He's saying, Father, those that you've given me, who did the Lord give you? Every single believer. Why? Paul says that you are in Christ. And so God says, whoever, I don't care how bad a man's life or a woman's life has been, says the Lord. The moment they confess and acknowledge and trust in what my son did for them, you know what? They're holy. They're blameless without blemish. Yeah, but Lord, he's a murderer. They're holy. They're blameless. Yeah, but Lord, he's a prophet. They're holy. They're blameless. There is not a single soul that cannot be bought and paid for completely by that soul acknowledging what Jesus Christ has done. There is not a single act, no matter how bad it can be, that can separate us from the love of God when we come to the Lord. But you know what the beautiful thing is? You know what the amazing thing? Because the biggest thing about sharing this, what we would call grace message, is people come and they say, yes, but Adrian, you know, you talk about grace, you talk about grace, you know, but people have got grace, then they can just go out and do what they want. Now, I ask you this. If you drink municipal tap water, right? And then I bring you beautifully Tsitsikamma spring, what do they call it? Whatever. You've got to read the label. It says filtered water. It says from the highest springs in the mountains of the Tsitsikamma Valley. Do they know baboons are up there? But anyway. They clean it. And I say, right, you've been drinking municipal water, which is not too bad, but it's got other goodies in there to kill critters that shouldn't be in there. And you drink this filtered water. And I then say, okay, which would you prefer? If you say to me the municipal water, then we've got a problem. Because you've tasted of the cleanliness. Folks, if you've tasted of the grace of God and the forgiveness of God, why would you want to go back and do the things that we're doing? Yes, you can. And God's going to say, I'm there for you. But why would you want to go back? Because then, have you truly tasted of God's forgiveness? Have you tasted of the peace that you can have? True peace. And you say, I know this peace. And you know what? I want this peace. Because there's nothing you can do that's going to give you that peace in your own right. Deuteronomy 28 says, God was giving to the nation of Israel instruction. And notice the difference with what he says to the nation of Israel in the Old Testament and what he says to us today. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto me, if you shall hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and, right, so you hearken to the voice of the Lord, and do all, not believe in, do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth. 28:2. And all things, all these blessings, I beg your pardon, shall come on thee. If you do that, if you hearken to it, and if you do the commandments, then these blessings are going to come on you. And they will overtake you. In other words, they will be greater than you can even begin to imagine. If, again, thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. If. Paul says, 2 Timothy 1:9. Who shall save us? And called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, not if you do this and if you hearken, not according to works, but according to his purpose and grace, which was given us In Christ Jesus, before the world began, the gift that you have received, if you've acknowledged what Jesus Christ has done, was packaged and prepared for you before the world began. Now that's love. That's love. It's totally different to what the nation of Israel were told to do. Totally different. So then what do we do with this? Well, do we know? Do you believe that you accepted in Christ? Ephesians 1, 5 and 6. Having predestinated, that predestination means pre-planned, us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise and the glory of his grace, wherein he has made us accepted in the beloved. The predestination is not, okay, I'm taking the rest of you, tough luck, whatever you do, doesn't matter, you're not going to make it to heaven. It doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. We are predestined to be part of God's glorious plan in Christ. Folks, the provision in Christ is sufficient. If every single soul, every soul that has walked the face of this earth, every soul that is still to walk the face of this earth, was to come to Christ, you know what? The provision will exceed that. God doesn't say, well, sorry guys, I've only got this budget. I mean, the Super Kings have been given a budget of 14 million now to get their house in order. If somebody resigned, which he did, but anyway, it was conditional. Ours is not conditional. It's conditional in this sense that you have to acknowledge what is done for you. The lady who got the gift could have said, no, thank you. It's an old gift. I don't want it. But I said, we all want it. I get more enjoyment out of other people opening gifts than myself. You know, I like to see that enjoyment. Anyway, if you want a visit from me, what you do is you say, hi, Aiden, I've got some presents I'm going to open. Would you like to come out for a cup of coffee and ask me 10 questions? I'm kidding. Romans 8, 22-23. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain until now. Not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. Even we ourselves, Paul says, groan within ourselves. Why? Because of this brokenness of this world. What are we waiting for? The adoption. To wit, which means to, which is the redemption of our body. Folks, we as believers, we have the Holy Spirit living within us. We know that we are sealed. We know that God is ours. We know that God is with us. But we still grow. We grapple and we battle with life. Why? Because we're waiting for the redemption of the body. And when is that going to happen? The redemption of the body is the salvation of the body. How does our body get saved? One of two ways: physical death or the rapture. Death is your salvation from the brokenness of this world, folks. But we hold on because we think this is all life is. And we fail to see, but our blessings are spiritual blessings. They're in Christ, in heavenly places. Romans 8, 24 and 25. For we are saved by hope. But hope that is seen is not hope. For what man seeth, why doth he yet hope for it? But if we hope for what we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Folks, the scriptures say, your hope is in Christ. That hope is not my hope thing. It's an absolute assurance. The scriptures clearly teach that your hope is in Christ. You trust the Lord Jesus Christ for what he has done for you. Do not put yourself under a performance system. Your boss will do that at work. Okay? God is not about doing an appraisal on you. He's done his appraisal. His appraisal has been put on the Lord Jesus Christ, and Christ came up trumps. Why do you want to go through an appraisal system? You just say, Lord, I trust in what the Lord Jesus Christ has done, and thank you because of that. I get the appraisal Christ got. And you know what the appraisal is? Righteousness. Holiness. Peace. Redemption. Joy. Patience. Last night said, my wife and I had an amazing workshop experience together in life. said, well, that's fantastic. Yes, I work and she shops. I said, you know, I'm joking. He said, no, no, I'm just kidding. So I said, well, what does she do? He says, believe it or not, she studies the scriptures. I said, oh man, there's a wife for you. Because you know what? She's teaching your kids. She's got two kids. She's teaching your kids the most important thing. And he says, I absolutely know that and recognize that. And that's why we believe it's important. Praise the Lord for that. Folks, you're accepted in Christ. Don't put yourself under a reward system. The good that you do, the change in your life that comes about, is because it's you must be motivated by grace. Because of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, you motivate it. Because you say, Lord, what I've got is so free. You've given it to me all. How can I disappoint you? But even if I do, even if I stumble and fall, Lord, you never ever leave me or forsake me. Thank you. Folks, my prayer this morning for you is that you begin to understand, that you advance in your understanding of the Lord Jesus Christ as we work through Ephesians together. Now we've done Ephesians chapter 1, 1 to 6. And I said we're going to do it in 10 minutes. Alright! We'll see how we go. Because I'm going to stop there. I can carry on, but we're going to stop there. I leave with you. I hope this morning that in your mind you've got this beautiful, glorious message of what Christ has done for you. That you take it, you unwrap that in so completely as you read the scriptures, and you allow it to filter into your mind and into your whole essence of who you are, and that you live with that glorious message in your heart every single day. God bless you. Thank you for listening. Let us pray. Gracious, eternal Heavenly Father, as we come before you, thank you, Lord, that as we come before you this morning, and Lord, we've got to come to a realization and an acknowledgement that, Lord, we are not perfect in our own right. And there is nothing that we can bring to you in our own right. As Paul the Apostle said, that if there's anybody that could boast, he could boast. But he declared it was nothing compared to what he had in the living Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Help us see that. Help open our eyes, Lord, that we can begin to see the truth of your word. That your word begins to speak to the very depths of our soul. That, Lord, we begin to be motivated by your grace, your free gift of love, that we fully unwrap this gift and allow it to speak to our hearts and our minds. Help us reach out to each other. Help wives and husbands reach out to each other in love, in compassion and care. Lord, help families reach out to each other as they understand the value that you place upon the soul of every single person. That there is not one person, Lord, that we can say is less important than us. Yes, Lord, there are changes that need to be brought about in our lives. But Father God, if we were to stand in a mirror and if we were to declare anyone unclean, it would have to be ourselves. Help us to first look at our own lives. And through your guidance, your help, and your scriptures, do that which is right. And then, with an uncondemning heart, reach out and build one another up in the truth of your word. We thank you for this in Christ's name.